My name is Aurora Tan, and I'm working with Happens Victoria, and I'm a Chinese migrant, and you know, first I want to acknowledge the traditional owners. On which we are meeting today. I pay my respect to the elders and all the community elders in this room. Thank you. And we maybe take a deep breath. It's a long day.
Right. So over 230,000 Australians are currently living with chronic hepatitis B. Have you ever heard about the disease in the past before you walked into the summit today? If that's the case, can you please raise your hand and I can quickly have a look. Thank you. Yes. So it's a major cause of liver cancer, and chronic hepatitis B, unfortunately, it's disproportionately affect private population, including those born overseas in endemic countries and areas, particularly the Asia Pacific, Middle East, and the Sub-Sahara Africa regions, including Australian born communities who trace ancestry to these regions. So at the end of 2015, of the estimated over 230,000 chronic hepatitis B Australians, 38% people were born in the Asia Pacific region and 4% people were born in Sub-Saharan Africa. So for many women living with chronic hepatitis B, pregnancy is actually the first time they learn that they have the chronic condition. However, currently, women who are being diagnosed during pregnancy are not being offered adequate health and support post-delivery in order to manage their condition. So in the past several years, Hepatitis Victoria successfully implemented two main hepatitis B awareness and health promotion projects aiming to empower people living with or at risk of chronic hepatitis B from migrant and refugee backgrounds to prevent transmission, to promote testing, vaccination, and access to treatment, and to reduce hepatitis B-related stigma and discrimination. So our project, Moms to Be, focuses on parents and women of childbearing age and the understood, such as the general whole community. So through our literature reviews and needs assessment, these things were conducted to identify knowledge gap and the support needs of these communities around chronic hepatitis B and to guide programs designing. And also information resources were developed in consultation with the community members. So over 20 health organizations within Victoria kindly provided support through stakeholder partnership, and our education sessions were delivered to multiple ethnic community groups, including Chinese, Vietnamese, Afghan, Burmese, Cambodian, South Sudanese, and Egyptian. Our bilingual peer facilitators were recruited and trained to deliver sessions in participants' mother tongue. The facilitators also provide input into program planning and ensure it was culturally appropriate. Evaluation data showed that knowledge of hepatitis B was greatly improved. Moreover, most participants acknowledged the importance of the sessions to empower themselves to better care for families, implying the dissemination of information after the session among community members. So the key factor for the success was the inclusion of our community peer facilitators. These peer facilitators were crucial regarding gaining support from community organizations, enabling active engagement with participants and deliver information in a more accurate and meaningful way, avoiding misinterpretations that sometimes happen in interpreter assisting sessions. So some key challenge for the future include maintaining a stable pool of peer facilitators, securing ongoing funding for implementing sustainable programs, and maintaining healthy stakeholder relationships within the community, including the relationship with community leaders, community media, and community event organizers, and will serve the ongoing awareness and the community education opportunities. So in the clinic setting these days, we often hear people promote the practice and the concept of people-centered care. And in Hepatitis Victoria, in our field work, we believe and promote community-centered, community-led, and community-driven programs.
Community participation allowed us to embed the voice of affected community across our work. So today, I would like to thank Dr. Mimi and thank the summit organizer and all the stakeholders to provide the opportunity for us to share the learning outcome of our community participation program, the health promotion program, and have the chance to make a connection with you. And hopefully, you will look into our community participation program and exploring, and see there's a chance. Ideally, you will become a volunteer or member of the organization, and at the same time, in the future, you might bring that resource into your community and working with people from especially Sub-Saharan Africa. Thank you. Thank you very much for your question. First, I just want to acknowledge that Dr. Chris Limo sitting in this room. He is one of the key stakeholders of our community participation in the community education project. So it's very good to see him over here. And thank you so much for your question. So at this stage, the main reason why I'm here today is making connection with our African community members, because we are at the starting point to actually launch our application form to create future programs to make sure the program is actually shaped through the designing of African community members, and then in the future potentially lead by the African community groups. That's why regarding cultural appropriate, learning from the current successful programs through Chinese and Vietnamese and Afghan community members. So we want to engage our African community members to join us to take the lead to actually design the project and get the funding and driving into the future to make it sustainable and working for our community members. So I hope that answered your question. Yes. So the reason why we communicate with our communicate with our community members through all the free community educations is trying to help people to understand the transmission routes of hepatitis B, and also the prevention testing and the navigating the healthcare to access vaccination. So I don't think I have that time to go through all the details because it will be another 1 hour talk, but I will encourage you to contact us. We have our information store outside this room. Please pick up all the resources and put into that purple lobby liver bag and contact us, and we will come to you, provide the decision, but it will be shaped and designed according to your culture appropriately. So that's why this is still very preliminary stage. We try to engage our community members from African background. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
But I've been asked a question. Hepatitis C is spread by blood, basically. Can be sexual transmission, but very rarely. And so it's basically blood to blood. That's how hepatitis C is transmitted. So just ordinary contact is not contagious. The hepatitis C will be prevented by not sharing anything which will draw blood from one person, and then that blood will go into the second person's body. So with a blood transfusion, injections where the same needle is put in one person than another person, a transplant where the person who gives the organ has hepatitis C and then it goes into the body of the person as a transplant, or in injecting drugs, people use the same needle or they use the same equipment, the blood from one person can go into the blood of the other person. So to prevent it is not to do any of those things where one person's blood.
Before I start, I'd just like to acknowledge the sovereign lands of the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation. I pay my respect to elders past, present and future as a person of migrant heritage, seeking to explore home and life on what was, is and always will be Aboriginal land. And I think that's a very important aspect, especially for people from migrant backgrounds, when you look at health outcomes compared to the First Nations people of this country. So hopefully it's something that we can always remember in our relative practice. And just a disclaimer, for some reason I'm just Miss Hope Matumbu. I'm not a doctor, but even if I was, this would still be true. So any information contained in this presentation is not, it's just to provide general information and it's not intended for any sort of specific health needs or purposes. Please see your primary health care provider about any personal health concerns. So I am a member of the Victorian African Health Action Network, the president is actually Dr. Chris Lamoe, who's sitting back there. And I've been a member for 3 years now. And the VAHAN, as it's abbreviated, has been raising awareness about issues around bloodborne viruses and sexually transmitted infections since 2011, but specifically trying to talk about these issues or create a space about these issues in relation to African Australians. And the reason for VAHAN is that the Australian response to HIV has been characterized by a strong productive partnership between policymakers, healthcare providers, researchers, people living with HIV and communities affected by HIV. And there's a lot of communities affected by bloodborne viruses and STI, so HIV and hepatitis B and C are known as bloodborne viruses, and hepatitis B is also a sexually transmissible infection. So sometimes when I talk about HIV, it's not just about HIV, it's about bloodborne viruses like we're talking hep C, hep B, and other sexually transmissible infections. But anyways, here in Australia, there are many associations or organizations that represent different affected populations. So there's an association for people who are living with HIV, there's an association for people who identify as sex workers, there's even an association for people who are injecting drug users. So these are key, what we call key populations. But so far, there's no organization that exists to try and talk about the concerns of African Australian communities when we talk about the development and implementation of different policies in relation to bloodborne viruses and STIs. So this is why VAHAN, and why I joined VAHAN, because as someone who's worked in health promotion specifically and in sexual and reproductive health, there was a lack of representation or dialogue for African people. Anyway, VAHAN does not claim to represent Victoria's African communities because, again, Africa is diverse, and this is one of the things that you'll find in our strategy, is that how do, and a lot of the times when, any stuff that's sort of health-related, people like to talk about African communities, but who are they talking about? I myself am South African. And how I migrated here, I came here as a migrant and not as a refugee, and that affects the ways in which I interact with healthcare systems here in Australia. So I guess VAHAN as well is just here as a platform for people from different diasporas, African Australian diasporas, to sort of like talk in a nuanced way about the proper way to effectively respond to issues around bloodborne viruses and STIs. And I think that it's really important that African Australian voices are centered when we talk about the development of policy, because sometimes the policies that we see coming out don't really address the key concerns or issues for African Australians. So VAHAN works to improve community awareness about HIV, viral hepatitis, and STIs. We're about promoting discussion about health and social issues that put people at risk of exposure, delay diagnosis, and prevent those living with these conditions from getting access to treatment. And we work to facilitate meaningful engagement of communities. So I guess the reason, we've kind of gone over the reason why there's a need for an African Australian community-based response. But also the other thing is the impact of migration on bloodborne viruses and STIs. Globally, there are about 1 billion people on the move at any given time. Migration can place people in situations of heightened vulnerability to sexually transmissible infections. And a lot of the times, migrants, and especially women who are migrants, are vulnerable to STI and bloodborne virus transmission. As well, a lot of countries, including Australia, have travel and migration restrictions on people living with bloodborne viruses or STIs. And so that sort of plays into a lot of the issues that affect us. And so, 1 minute. Oh, I've got 1 minute. So the other reason is that if we look at the statistics, Australia has been a country where the transmission of bloodborne virus or STIs has largely been around men who have sex with men. But now that we're, with the effects of migration and that sort of thing, whilst those like stats in that area sort of going down, 218 newly diagnosed cases of HIV in 2015 were amongst people from a migrant background. So they were diagnosed overseas with a confirming test here in Australia. 25% of all diagnoses between 2009 and 2013 were among heterosexual couples. And now if you look at the global trends in terms of like globally, it's mostly heterosexual sex that plays a role in transmission. So the statistics are gradually changing, and we'll find that more people from migrant backgrounds will have a representation in these statistics going forward. So this is another reason why it's really important to look at things from this context and to start a conversation for African Australians amongst these issues. So I'm just going to.
Yeah, if you can just wrap up and we will upload your presentation.
Great.
Sorry about that.
No, that's okay. And the other thing is that when it comes to migration, there's been little concerted effort to incorporate gender into this. And so it's really important, there's very little known about African women and the reasons why they migrate, or the predominance of women in certain labor flows. And so this is also important for us as women to step up and have some of these conversations. But anyways, the presentation will be uploaded. But just for some of you, towards the end of the year in December, World AIDS Day, the Victorian African Health Action Network will be hosting a series of forums. And so if you can please jump on our website and follow us. Soon we will also have a social media presence. And going forward, it would be really great to have more African Australians involved in a dialogue that's central to our health. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm so sorry.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Desiree Obodiashite. I'm just going to share with you the findings I did about the vitamin D project, and to hopefully empower you about the things that I found, so that from today onwards you can take some steps to increase your vitamin D intake. Generally, people know vitamin D is important for the health, but when you ask people what vitamin D really does in their body, most people just tell it's good for the bones, it's good for the muscles, and that's where it stops. But vitamin D actually does more. It's been shown that vitamin D prevents diseases like diabetes, breast cancer, colon cancer. It helps in supporting the immune system. Diseases like autoimmune diseases like atherosclerosis, multiple sclerosis, vitamin D has been shown to help prevent such diseases. So don't think about vitamin D as something that is very trivial, just for the bone and muscle, but think of it as something that even goes further. There are more health benefits that vitamin D can offer us. As African women in particular, because of the dark melanin we have some issues with producing vitamin D. My aim in the study was to understand why there is this widespread knowledge that vitamin D is a problem. But why is it a problem? How much do we Africans know about this problem, and what are the factors that contribute to this being a problem? What attitudes do we have towards vitamin D, and how do we think about vitamin D? So I'll just tell you a few things about the sources of vitamin D, because I think most people think about the sun as the only source of vitamin D, but when you look at things like egg yolk, oily fish like sardines, mackerel, herrings, salmon, they are all sources of vitamin D. And luckily enough in Australia, there are some types of butter and milk that are fortified with vitamin D. So you just have to check. For example, I buy butter from Aldi and I check the bottom and it contains vitamin D. So you just have to look at other sources of vitamin D. Things like Ostalin. We have supplements that are also sources of vitamin D. There are even some mushrooms that are treated to produce vitamin D. So whenever you go shopping, just open your eyes and be conscious about what you are eating and what it contains. It is recommended that people aged between 1 year and 70 years take a daily intake of 600 international units of vitamin D. And one tablet of Ostalin contains 1,000 international units of vitamin D. Now, I'd like to talk a bit about the sun, because when we come here, it's a temperate climate. We are used to being in the sun in Africa, but when we come here, the weather is a bit different. But what I'd like to encourage you is that the sun is actually good. Many people that I spoke to during my my research, what they said, the Australian sun is so harsh. It's so harsh. You just have to know the times to sit in the sun and your exposure. Once you know that, you'll be able to make most use of the sun. And also during winter times, actually there are times that you can actually sit in the sun. So I'll just run you through a table, especially for us in Victoria. So as for us in Victoria, during the summertime, the peak time for sun exposure is between 10 a.m. and 2 p.m. So when you sit in the sun and expose, especially for our sisters who have covered with veils, expose your hands and your legs if you can, and expose as much part of your body for 30 to 50 minutes during these times, 10 a.m. to 2 p.m., you can get your recommended daily intake of vitamin D from sun exposure. During the winter times too, sometimes the sun comes out. So when you have time, you can sit in the sun from 1.5 hours to 2.5 hours, and you should be able to get the amount of vitamin D you need. But I would add that it's important that you supplement your vitamin D during the winter time with the tablets like Ostalin, or when you go to the chemist, there are vitamin D tablets that you can take to supplement your intake during winter. Yep, so I already mentioned this in the beginning. Okay, so when I did my study, I found that, like I mentioned in the beginning, most people know about vitamin D and what it does, but it only ends that, oh, vitamin D is good for bone health. And what I would like to encourage you all today is to take active steps to educate yourself about vitamin D and other things that affect your health. Because once you are able to empower yourself with knowledge, when you go to see the doctor, or when something doesn't feel right in your body, you can say, oh, okay, I've read here and here that this could possibly be what is happening. When you go to the doctor, engage with them. I know back home when we go to the doctor, we are afraid to say, oh, doctor, to speak to them. We always wait for the doctor to talk to us, and we bring it here. Take ownership of your health. When the doctor is having a conversation with you, talk back. Ask them questions. When they give you medication, you know, ask them, okay, what are my other options? Engage with them. And even when they ask for blood tests, ask them, oh, doctor, would you like to include a test for vitamin D? So that if your vitamin D levels are low, then you can take steps to increase your levels. And I'll just finish by saying also that from our background as Africans, we tend to be in a tight-knit community. Share your experiences, share your knowledge with each other, so that that's where we can share the knowledge and then empower each other. And even if you would like to, you know, raise things up, and every once in a while you have community groups, invite people in your group to speak to you about health issues that are affecting you. just like to include a last point because this is quite important. For the sun, I would encourage you, don't be afraid of the Australian sun. I know always in the media they say the sun causes skin cancer, but our melanin provides protection for us. So I would encourage you, please, and talk to your sisters. Skin bleaching is a big problem in our communities. You are eroding the thing that prevents you from getting skin cancer. Once you start bleaching your skin, you are eroding it. And once you start eroding that, you start to get the skin cancer and other things. So please talk to your fellow sisters in your community. Let's keep our melanin and also take steps to increase our vitamin D intake. Also for the mothers here, when your children go to school and they have to apply sunscreen, own that. Tell the teachers that my child needs to be in the sun for a little bit, at least 30 to 45 minutes. Let the child be in the sun without the sunscreen, and then later on apply the sunscreen, because vitamin D is very important for child development and for brain development. So please take ownership of your health.
Thank you. Don't forget to leave your presentation.
Topic is not very new, because actually throughout this course of this summit, we've been talking about a lot of these issues. So mine is just to confirm, because we did an appropriate study, and the topic is intergenerational conflicts between older and younger African migrants, and this was the case in South Australia, and even in Adelaide, so this is the case in South Australia, but I hope you can also relate with this. So why did we do this study? We didn't initiate this study. Community leaders came to the university and they asked us to explore why are there so many suicides in the community. At that time, this was 2012, and there were about 7 suicides of African young people during that time, which is a lot. So there's a lot of over-representation of suicide among Africans compared to the general population. So they asked us about what can we do about this particular problem, and we say we cannot really do anything unless we did a proper study to know and to ask people themselves what are the issues. And because we have only 5 minutes, so I hope I can summarize this very quickly. So we did a qualitative study, and when you do a qualitative study, really you can explore as much as possible and ask in detailed information about really issues. So we did that qualitative study with 31 people, older Africans and younger Africans. We started by a big focus group discussion, but we really found the Africans are too diverse and you cannot really mix them together and ask questions together. So we changed our strategy and did the interview one-on-one. So we did the one-on-one interviews and we found that really Africans are quite diverse and they come from diverse communities. And the majority of populations who came to participated, who volunteered to participate in our study were mainly refugees, and this is consistent with the proportion of Africans in Australia. The humanitarian entrants are the major component of the African migrants. So the majority of this population, so that I may seem like I'm talking about the other, but I'm also included, they are from rural settings, and really life is very simple. If we came from to the other session, we have heard about really people being very happy where they were, even though it was very unsafe. Even coming here is even more complicated. So these people who come from this rural background, they come to cities like Adelaide. So Adelaide is a metropolitan city, it's very complex. So people who do not necessarily have education, they've never been exposed to such big areas. They come and they have to look for accommodation, they have to look for finances, even though they are getting money from Centrelink, but this is not really enough because they have to send money back, yet they have other relatives or significant others who are still in refugee camps, and they have sent the little money which they are getting here. So all these complications, they have to learn the language, and they have to deal with the children who are growing up here. So this is what I've just said, and particularly those who have refugee background, they have really run their life with a lot of things. So when they come here, they actually bombarded with many issues, and young people, as you would know, they acculturate very fast, which means they change their African identity and try to cope with their friends here. But then they are not really particularly Australians because they are still Africans, they live with their parents. And the parents don't necessarily understand why would my child become a white or Australian. And they think these children are too Australians, and the children are not really Australians. They are still Africans, but they are not Africans. So those confusions are very, very confusing. Our own cultural restrictive values, where we know that we know what we want for our children, what our children could be. You know, we have brought them here to become houses and to take opportunities. That, those are our own cultural values and expectations. These are not expectations of our children. So those restrictive values of saying this is what we've got to do are very confusing to children. They bring a lot of conflicts, inner conflicts and also interpersonal conflicts. This is also coupled with the discrimination. We've heard about racism next door before we came here. And this leads to isolation. They don't necessarily come up. As you know, the majority of people who have come as refugees, they have also left their networks back home. They don't necessarily have the networks here, so they are isolated. They are themselves, and they cannot really cope. So that intergenerational conflicts, the differentials in acculturation and the taking up of the new culture, the host culture, which is very free, you can drink, you can do this, you can do that, which is conflict with our own culture, that's very, 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 very heavy. And that impacts on the mental health of young people. And we really thought that could be one of the reasons, or likely reasons, to cause suicide in this community. Just 1 minute, okay? Yeah, okay. We did this for 2-3 months, just collecting data, so yes, 1 minute. So really, pre-migration adjustment, acculturation, settlement, these are conflicts themselves, let alone the behaviors which emerge as children and parents live here. So the contextual differences between the generations, the older generations and the younger generation, they bring about the bombardment and the conflicts, which is personal conflicts, inner conflicts, and intergenerational conflicts. And this is really very stressful, and therefore one of the causes of suicide among our young people. So typically, as you know, these young people have really gone through the trauma of migrating. As you know, some of these would have migrated to one country or even two before they came here. So coupled with the challenges of settlement, these things are very complex, and our young children or young people, we don't necessarily understand it. So overall, really, I cannot summarize in 1 minute, but understanding some of these issues which are emerging in our communities, and we have heard these issues over and over and over during the summit. These are very important community issues. And for all the migrants, both ourselves and our young children, we've got to communicate and try to understand each other. So that communication that you, younger people, understand the parents and parents understand the younger people, those are one of the, some of the mitigating factors which are related to low suicide rates in our community.
Thank you. Thank you very much. That's such an important topic. I'm really sorry about that. Thanks a lot. We have actually now exactly 5 minutes to have an afternoon tea where we can ask your question.
I'm just trying to say, whether it be a migrant or refugees, we all are African. The word you say, I think as a migrant, not as a refugee, was a very strong word. If you want for everyone to be inclusive, you have to be more moderate of saying that. Because whether it be migrant or refugees, we all came here to seek help from this government.
I'm sorry, Auntie. And I understand what you're saying, but how I meant it, and I didn't mean any offense, so what I meant is that for people who are economic migrants, such as myself, access, I've had the privilege of having access to certain things.
So I can never speak about your experience as a refugee because I've had access to different things. And so I'm saying that I'm in a, it, the way that we approach health then is different. So what I'm saying is that as an African migrant, economic migrant, we came here because my mother is a nurse. She got a job here. I am treated differently because of that, even though we're both African and we're both black. And people don't realize, it was recently Refugee Week, people don't realize what people, you know, you can never get rid of this term refugee. As soon as you tell someone you're a refugee, they'll never think of you as a doctor, they'll never think of you as this or this or that. And that, unfortunately, is a disadvantage of this label refugee. So that's all I was meaning.